Let's say the verse one more time.
Okay, try to say with your eyes closed. Ready?
Ephesians 5:23. Even as Christ is the head of the church, and he is the Savior of the body.
All right. Now.
What are you going to do about our feet?
Well, we'll just have to see. So, how many of you saw Mr. Korzynski take the brownies off the shelf? How many of you saw that? You see it? I saw it. So, the Bible has a word, and we still use this word today, but it's not as often. The Bible has a word for somebody. So, if we saw, everybody that saw him take those brownies, you could tell me. Somebody tell me what he did.
He stole the fucking brownies.
How did it happen?
He ran up
and took them. Somebody else want to tell me what happened? Moses, what happened? But how? He ran up there and he took them. Okay? Anybody else want to tell me? Sabrina, what did you see? He grabbed it and ran away. So all of you saw it. You know what we call that when you saw something and you tell someone else what you saw? You know what you call that?
A snitch.
No, it's not a snitch. Absolutely not. It's not a snitch. It is a witness. A witness. All of you witnessed him taking that. You are witnesses that you saw him take it. Now, we're going to fix that taking it. And Mr. Korzynski, thank you for doing that, because I needed you to do that so we could learn, so we could see what the word, so that we could become a witness. All of you are witnesses of what he did. Right? Because you all saw it. And so you're witnesses of it. If you go home and say, hey mom, today Mr. Korzynski took the brownies off the shelf, what are you doing? You're giving a witness to what you saw. And then you say later on, Pastor Goldman took them back and put them back up there. And you witnessed that too. You saw it and you're a witness to it. When Jesus was on the earth with his disciples, after he rose from the dead, remember that he lived and then they killed him, right? They crucified him as a criminal. Was Jesus a criminal? No. Had he ever done anything wrong? No. Had he ever lied? Had he ever cheated? Had he ever stolen brownies off the shelf? No. He never did any single thing wrong. He didn't even have a bad thought. He was perfect. But they killed him like he was a criminal. And after they killed him, what did they do? What happened to him? They put him in the grave, right? They put him in the tomb, and then he was in the tomb the next day, and the third day, he rose from the dead, right? It was a surprise. None of the disciples were expecting it. They should have been, but they weren't. But that day, they all saw him. They saw him. He was alive. And then the next week, they saw him again. And then another time, up in Galilee, where so all that happened in Jerusalem, another time up in Galilee, where they were mostly from, they saw him. They listened to him teach. They saw him eat food. They knew, because they saw it, that he was alive, he rose from the dead. And then, remember, 40 days after he rose from the dead, he was on the Mount of Olives, and he was talking to them. And what happened? He rose from the dead 40 days before. He was there talking with him, and all of a sudden, he went to heaven. How did he go to heaven? How did Jesus go to heaven? Serenity, you remember? No, that's how we can go to heaven, because he sacrificed his life for us. Right, but how did Jesus go to heaven? He was on a mountain. Olives, he was talking with his disciples, and he just ascended. He just went up, he floated up into the sky, into the clouds, and into heaven. Right before he did that, he said, all of you disciples are going to be witnesses to me. Now, what did that mean? He said, you're going to witness to me in Jerusalem. That's where they were, Jerusalem. And you're going to witness to me in Judea. And you're going to witness to me in Samaria and unto the end of the earth. He said, you'll be witnesses. So all of you witnessed, and you could witness to someone else that Mr. Porzinski took the brownies. That doesn't mean anything. But Jesus told his disciples, you're going to tell people in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, all the way to the end of the earth, you're going to witness that I'm alive. You're going to be witnesses to me. So, today we're talking about that witness. What did the disciples, once they, after that, they went up in the upper room, they prayed, they didn't have any arguments, they all agreed together, and on the 10th day after that, there was the sound of a mighty rushing wind, right? And it looked like there was little flames of fire above their head. And what happened? The Holy Spirit came, and on that day, all the disciples went out talking to everybody in the city, and there was hundreds of thousands in the city, and they were telling them about the wonderful things of God. What were the wonderful things of God? Jesus was alive. Jesus had come. He died. He rose. He had gone to heaven. They were witnessing there that day. They were telling people what they saw, what they knew. But what was special on that day, they spoke in their language, but the people that were listening to them heard it in their own language, in a different language. Wow! But the disciples that day, they began to actually be witnesses. They told the people in Jerusalem about Jesus. What did they tell them about Jesus? What did they tell those people in Jerusalem about Jesus? What do you think they told them? About the Bible. They told the people in Jerusalem that day that Jesus was the Lord, that he was the Messiah. And what did the people they thought? We thought he was a criminal. We killed him. But Peter said, no, God has made him both Lord and Christ. It happened on the cross. Jesus had talked earlier when he was teaching on the earth that everybody in the world is on this big, broad road. They're on a big, broad road. That everybody's on this broad road, but Jesus knew what was at the end of the road. He said at the end of the road is destruction. You can't see it there, but that's smoke representing the fire of hell. At the end of the broad road is destruction. Jesus said, some people, a very few, make it onto the narrow road. They have to strive. He said, you should strive. You should work hard to get onto the narrow road. And you know why it's hard to get onto the narrow road? Because you have to turn away from yourself. Every single one of us thinks that what we're doing is the best thing in the world. We think that we are okay. We think that we're doing just fine. That we'll make it all with our own ability. We're not that bad. But Jesus says, no, you are. You are a sinner. And since you're a sinner, I had to die on the cross, but I did. Jesus died on the cross to forgive our sins. We have to turn from our sins, turn from ourselves, believe on Jesus. And when we do that, and sometimes that's hard to do because we like to do what we want to do and not what God wants to do. But when we turn from our sin and believe on Jesus, that puts us on the narrow road. And at the end of the narrow road is heaven and Jesus. So the disciples told people that they needed to believe on Jesus, that Jesus had died on the cross, but he wasn't a criminal. He was the Savior. Did people listen to them? Yes. Some people did. On that first day, the Bible says 3,000 people believed and they were baptized and they were added to the number of disciples that there were. 3,000 of them. And after that, other people began to listen and to obey the gospel and believe on it. So, the rulers of the people, they didn't really like that. They took the disciples and they said, you can't be talking about Jesus. Now, why did they say that? Why did the rulers say, don't be talking about Jesus? Serenity, what do you think? Why didn't the rulers want them talking about Jesus? Right, and who crucified him? The rulers, right? The rulers crucified him. They didn't want people saying that they crucified Jesus. So they told the disciples, you can't be talking about it. In fact, they even put him in jail. They put him in jail for witnessing about Jesus. What do you think happened? You think they stopped witnessing? No, they didn't. In fact, the Bible says an angel came and broke them out of jail. And you think, what did they got out of jail and did they run and hide? Nope. They went right back to the temple where the rulers of the people were and they started telling them about Jesus. And the ruler said, tell you not to do that, and Peter started preaching to the rulers. And he preached to the rulers and told them about Jesus. And also, not just that Jesus was crucified and that they had to believe on him, but that he rose from the dead. Everywhere that the people that were believers in Jesus, the church, whenever they talked about Jesus and whenever they witnessed about Jesus, they witnessed, let's say, three things, maybe more than that, but three things. That Jesus was a perfect man, the Son of God, that they crucified him, and Jesus rose from the dead. And they said, we're witnesses of that. What did that mean? They had seen him, right? They had seen Jesus alive from the dead. And we are witnesses of that, they said. And so, Peter told the rulers, there is no other way to be saved except through Jesus. Neither is there salvation in any other than through Jesus Christ. Now the rulers, they didn't believe in Jesus. They had seen Jesus, but they didn't believe. But the disciples, they knew. They had witnessed it. And they were giving witness to Jesus, even to the rulers. And so the people heard about Jesus, from the disciples, from the apostles, the rulers heard about Jesus. Very soon, within about a year, everybody, okay, now this map is very small, you can't see much, but this is Jerusalem, and this word here is Judea. So within about a year, everybody in Jerusalem and Judea had heard the witness of the gospel, had heard the witness of Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. Not long after that, some of them went to Samaria. Now, I don't know, you might not remember this, but the Jews did not like the people in Samaria. In fact, there were Jews who lived up here in Galilee, and every time they had to go to the temple, they had to go to Jerusalem. So you would think they would just walk down the road to Jerusalem, but no, they didn't like these Samaritans in the middle here. They would walk over to this river, walk down the river around the Samaritans, and then back up to Jerusalem. They hated the Samaritans. They hated the people that lived in Samaria. But Jesus said, not only do I want you to go to those that crucified me here in Jerusalem and Judea, I want you to go to those that you don't like, people that you think are strange. They're different. You need to go and witness to them about me. And so did they do that? Yes, they did. They went up into Samaria and they told the people in Samaria about Jesus. One man, Philip, went there and they had lots and lots and lots and lots and lots of people got saved. And then the Holy Spirit told them to go down into this desert area here. And Philip was in the desert area there, and as he was there, he saw a man sitting in his chariot. Now, we don't drive chariots around, but this man was rich because he had a chariot. He wasn't just walking along. He was sitting in his chariot, and the Holy Spirit said, go up to that man. So Philip went up to that man, and as he got up there, he heard the man reading the Bible. How about that? So Philip said, do you know what you're reading? Do you understand what you're reading? And the man said, no, I need somebody to help me. And so what did Philip do? Philip got up in the chariot with him, and Philip gave a witness. He witnessed to that man about, who did he witness to him about? Jesus, right? The man was reading in the Old Testament some verses that were talking about Jesus, and Philip told him about Jesus. He witnessed to him about Jesus, and the man was going along, and he said, well, look, there's some water. Maybe I should get baptized. Well, where did that come from? Why would he get baptized? Well, he must have seen some people back in Jerusalem being baptized. And so Philip, what did Philip say? Did he say, well, sure, you can get baptized? No, he didn't. He said, if you believe, then you can be baptized. And the man said, I believe that Jesus is the Son of God. And so then they went down in the water, and that man was baptized. That man was from Ethiopia. So this is Jerusalem, Judea. They were right here. By the time that man got home, he was all the way down here, and he was an important man in the Ethiopian government. So he went down there, and what do you think he started doing? What do you think he started doing, Serenity? He was already reading the Bible. Now he knew that the Bible was about Jesus, and he knew Jesus had lived and died and rose again, and those that believe on him can have eternal life. What do you think he started doing? Moses? He was telling other people. What's another word for telling other people about Jesus? What's our word today for telling other people about Jesus? Starts with a W. Allie, witness. He was a witness now. Had he seen Jesus? No. But he met Jesus. Is Jesus alive? Yes. Can we know him by reading the Bible and believing on him? Yes. So the Ethiopian ruler, government official, he went to Ethiopia and he began telling people about Jesus, witnessing to Jesus. You know, in those days, some people called Ethiopia the end of the earth. How about that? Now, there was other places, but that quick, they had gone, the gospel, the witnesses had witnessed about Jesus in Jerusalem and in Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth, and they kept on witnessing. When you witness and you tell people about Jesus, they have to make a choice, don't they? Here's this man right here. And in our mind, or in his heart, he's met up with the cross. He hears about the cross. Who died on the cross? Jesus died on the cross. Why did he die on the cross? Was he a wicked man? No. He was a perfect man. Was he just a man? No, he's God. But God died on a cross. Why? Because men are sinners. And if with their own sin, they will never get to heaven. But believing on Jesus, trusting in Jesus, obeying the gospel here, when people hear about Jesus, they have to make a choice. They have to choose. Are they going to go, keep going down that broad road that ends in smoke and hell? Or are they going to believe on him and go on the narrow road that goes to heaven? It's not what we do, it's what we decide. But it's a hard decision. It's a hard decision because we have to turn from what we think and believe on Jesus. It's not hard for children, really. It makes sense to children. But sometimes it's hard. When a little bit later, Peter was he was not preaching in Jerusalem anymore. He went out. Well, after Philip was done with this guy down here, he preached his way up to Caesarea. And then Peter went out, and he was in this area preaching, and he got a vision. We'll talk about this in a few weeks, probably. But God told him to go and witness to someone who wasn't a Jew, to a heathen man, to a Roman centurion. And Peter, at first he thought, should I do that? And then he realized that God wanted him to do that. It makes sense, right? If you're going to go to the end of the, if you're going to witness to the end of the earth, you're going to talk to people who aren't Jews. And so Peter went up and he preached the gospel. He told the centurion and his family, these people that were not Jewish people, about Jesus. He witnessed to them about Jesus. And he told them that those that believe on Jesus would have their sins forgiven. What does that mean? What does that mean to have our sins forgiven? So the witness that they gave was first, Jesus died on the cross. Jesus is Lord, he's God, and he died on the cross. Next, they said, Jesus, he didn't stay dead, he rose from the dead. Then they said, you have to decide, are you going to believe on Jesus or not? If you don't believe on Jesus, you're headed to hell. If you do turn to Jesus and believe on him, turn away from your sin, then you're on your way to heaven, and you will get your sins forgiven. When the Bible talks about sins, it kind of gives us the picture of a very heavy load. If you know that you're supposed to do something, let's say your mom or your dad says, I want you to do this. It's very clear. You know you're supposed to do it. Or they say, you're not supposed to do this. Whatever you do, don't do something. A little bit later, you're going throughout your day, and you decide to disobey that rule. What happens? In your heart and in your mind, it gets a little heavy, doesn't it? You think, I shouldn't have done that. And we get a burden, because we know we disobeyed. And the Bible says that our sins, because we're all sinners, are like a heavy burden. The more we understand what God expects, the heavier that burden is. God says we're to love him more than anything else. God says we're not supposed to steal. If you take something that's not yours, you've broken God's law, and that becomes a burden on you. When you lie, when you say something that's not true, that's sin. And that sin becomes a burden, and it's a heavy burden. And the burden of sin gets heavier and heavier. But when we come to the cross, when we come to Jesus, the Bible says that when we believe on Jesus, he forgives our sin. And it's like those sins are taken off of our back. Now, none of us has sin in a backpack. But our mind and our heart gets weighed down by sin. But when we come to Jesus, when we turn from our own way and believe on Jesus, he forgives our sin. And even after we're saved, even after we've done that for the first time, we make mistakes. We do our own thing again. But if we come back to him and confess our sins, that was the song that was being played right when we started this morning. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive ourselves our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So, the disciples, what did they do? What was their message? They were witnesses. What's a witness? Somebody who saw something, somebody who knows something, and tells someone else about it. The disciples knew that Jesus was God. They knew that Jesus was dead, but he rose from the dead. They knew that everybody needed to make a choice between Jesus or not, and they knew what the consequences, what the result of that choice was, and they knew that those that would believe on Jesus would have their sins forgiven. And because they knew that, they told other people about it. But you know what? Each of us, even though we haven't seen Jesus' body, because what happened to his body? He took it to heaven with him. But if you have believed on Jesus, then you know that Jesus forgave your sin. If you believe, if you read the understand and obey the Bible, you know that what I've said, what the disciples knew, we know too, because the Bible tells us that Jesus is God, that he's the Lord, that Jesus died on the cross, that he rose from the dead, that everybody needs to choose between Jesus and their own way. You know, there's all kinds of other religions, and there's important men that have been parts of those religions, but have any of them died? Yeah, in fact, they all died, didn't they? Did any of them come back from the dead? Nope. Not a one of them. So, Jesus is the only true Savior, and we need to, first off, when we understand this, we need to believe on Him ourselves. Turn from our own way, from our own thoughts, and say, whatever the Bible says is true, I'm going to obey God, I'm going to believe on Jesus, I'm going to do what He wants, because I need my sins forgiven. But then, one of the things he tells us to do is that we are supposed to be witnesses too. We are supposed to tell other people what we know, what we learned from the Bible. Because a lot of people, even in America, don't know what the Bible says. They don't live according to what the Bible says. And we're to be, if we've been saved, if Jesus has saved us, we're to be witnesses. We're not just supposed to tell people that we saw Mr. Korzynski take the brownies. We're supposed to tell people that Jesus saved us and he can save them too. We ought to think about that. Do you know that Jesus saved you? If not, you need to, when you understand that, you need to turn from your sin and believe on Jesus. And he'll give you eternal life. He'll forgive your sins and you can have fellowship yourself with God. But if you have believed on him, and you know that, do you know somebody who doesn't? You should try to tell them, be a witness to them. Tell them what Jesus has done for you so that they can decide to let Jesus do that for them too. Okay, next week we're going to learn just a little bit more about the church. Today we learn what the church does, what its message is, and it's, the church is a witness.